really great morning. A lot of good information has been shared, and now we're going to take it into talking about marketing automation and really planning for that customer experience. As we're moving into a bit of a new era with marketing automation, one of the things that I took from Jeremy's presentation is that brands want customers want their brands to be where they are when they want them. And that's something that marketing automation really helps with. So before we get started, if everybody wants to do a quick intro. Jeremy, I know you just did an intro, but if you want to say hello again and then...
Hiya, Evangelist.
My name is Ian Stanley. I'm a director of marketing for HubSpot, and I'm based out of the Dublin office.
Hi, and I'm Phil Draper. I'm the CMO of dotmailer, an email marketing company based just over there. And we've also got offices in America and Australia.
Okay. Thank you. So marketing automation has become somewhat of a buzzword recently, and we want to find out, what does that really mean to you, and what kind of misconceptions are out there that we've had to debunk as we, you know, talk about it and try to work it in with our marketing strategies. Do you want to start?
Yeah, I can. Yeah, I mean, I guess the answers may vary a little bit based upon our particular perspectives on the business. I mean, for us as an email marketing automation company, a lot about what we say is you can start small and scale quickly. You don't necessarily have to change all your systems and infrastructure to start feeling the benefit of automation and being able to send better messages with more personalization at the time when people want. And that's a lot about how we build our platform and what we try and say to our customers. But I guess that might also be slightly different, some parts there, I'm not quite sure. I'm not going to answer your question for you.
I think there's a couple of different angles on it. I think there's a lot of misconceptions around marketing automation. One about the complexity or the amount of investment that's involved, but also the affordability of it. So normally you think like, oh, it's a very complex thing, it's a big beast, and therefore costs a lot of money and a lot of investments. We don't see that. We see a lot of smaller companies investing it, and actually where bigger brands like the Coca-Colas of the world may not invest in inbound marketing, maybe they should think about it, but certainly for smaller brands that want to try and get an edge and build their business quickly, inbound marketing and marketing automation is definitely both affordable and achievable.
My take is really that shopkeeper story. There was a slide at the end of the old shopkeeper, and I was thinking back to my newsagent's friend who knew exactly who I was and what I wanted and stuff before I went in, and he got my order ready for me. I've spent a lot of time working with Sony PlayStation, and one of the things that they're using is they're using automation, for example, but they've been using it across hundreds of millions of customer journeys, and they have a really nice saying in their team internally, and it's about, we speak to our customers on their preferred channel. Now, the issue is they want to act like the corner shopkeeper, but you can't do that when you're managing a PlayStation network and hundreds of millions of different people at scale in real time within seconds. And how exactly do you do that? So all marketing technology really, for me, is enabling you to be that corner shopkeeper at scale, but it still takes people, because you can't automate an experience. It still takes people and agencies to figure out what that beautiful experience and that piece of content looks like.
Yeah, that's a great case study, and I was actually going to ask if you guys had case studies that you wanted to share where you were working cross-channel with marketing automation, so bringing in other channels and filling out that customer experience.
That's actually another misconception, actually, that a lot of people think that marketing automation is all about like email and, you know, drip campaigns and lead nurturing and all this kind of stuff, but it has to go beyond that. It has to live within social media, it has to live within the website, personalization, and all those different areas. So, I mean, I think starting at the very basics, before you even take on technology, before you think about like what the channels that you're going to use and the processes and the approach that you're going to take, you need to think about who your customer is and how they engage with the brand, the channels that they prefer to use, the time of when they actually want to engage, and then customize the whole experience based around that. So like taking it away from email marketing. I mean, at the end of the day, ultimately, we know that there's more and more email marketing being used every single day, and we also know more and more people are blocking email. So it's becoming less effective over time. Mm. Still an extremely effective channel, but it's becoming less effective. And as things move more towards dark social and all these kind of other interesting areas, we need to think about how we can adapt the approach to have a kind of personalized experience based on not only the information that we've gathered, but on the channels and the networks where people are.
Yeah. Although customers still do love email. There was a stat by the DMA where they surveyed what channel do you prefer to get your marketing messages in? Is it social and all the rest of these things? And email had the highest response rate for any channel in all age groups. And I think that it still has huge benefits. One of the things we found about how we work with email and social together is one of our clients, Odeon, they did a piece of work about what the average spend was of somebody that had Facebook, and it was 10p, and then for somebody that had email, and it was £1.50, and it was £2.40 if they had both those pieces of data. Mm-hmm. So I think it comes into a little bit about how if you're going to be cross-channel, I think that there's value in all those metrics, and actually when you get them all together, they can be really powerful. People live in a multi-touch point world now where, you know, it's not just a one blast and you're going to convince them. It is part of that journey and that experience. And I think the more channels that can be speaking to harmoniously, collecting data for different points, the better chance you've got is to make your marketing not feel like marketing, to make it feel like the thing that they want.
Mm-hmm. Wow, those are two really good answers. let me take a slightly dip, because I completely agree. And we're looking across our marketing cloud, and email is still the top performing. It's just it's not always the coolest thing to talk about, because we want to be looking at dark social and all sorts of other really fun, exciting things like we saw in that hype cycle. When Facebook launched Messenger for brands, there was a really interesting stat that came out of that, because marketers just love jumping on new shiny things, don't they? It's like we're the magpie industry. We always jump on the new stuff. And people still, they're researching brands about 80% on a mobile, but over 70% of transactions are still checked out in traditional channels, you know, using desktop and email. It's still the traditional channels which are the most effective. But for me, let me just give you a really quick example of marketing automation turned on its head. If you think about customer data, I call it big data, whatever we like, it's basically just purchase data, consumer data, social data from across wherever those social webs come from, and connected data. That's all big data is. It's just those four buckets kind of stuck together. So if a marketing cloud is to try and make sense of all that data in real time, it doesn't matter what you plug into it. Most Sony PlayStation plug in PlayStation Network, right? And there's CRM and purchase data and email and social. But what about if you're the NHS and you're trying to use marketing to solve really big problems? We're doing a lot of stuff with the NHS at the moment, and they found out, well, what if we could just plug in MRI data? What if we could plug in patient records and GP records and the 10,000 different research papers? And they're finding some really interesting things, apart from trying to diagnose disease. This is marketing technology, by the way. Apart from trying to diagnose some really, really big issues, they're finding things like they can save the NHS an absolute ton of money. This is one of the best business cases I've ever seen. For every 1% of the UK population that stays out of hospital, NHS had saved 200 million. So if you imagine you don't speak English as your first language and you could use natural language processing to see what people are searching for, they've got no idea where to go because there's 67,000 pages on the NHS's website. So you've got no idea. Now, if you've got real-time marketing technology that might normally be responding to a tweet, what if that just sends them to the right page of when they can go and get a solution to their problem instead of calling an ambulance for 600 quid or going to A&E and spending £50 on paracetamol? And that's where marketing technology, someone's just looked at that and thought, how can we solve some of the bigger problems, you know, by using exactly the same technology? So for us, you know, this isn't just about marketing automation to make more money and sell more stuff to people that, you know, this is like, how can we solve some bigger problems with these amazing tools?
Mm-hmm. So it sounds like with marketing automation, a lot of data is collected and a lot of data is used to really make everything work together and bring customers through a journey. How do you use that data ethically? And do you have any best practices to share?
I think it's a very personal thing, to be honest. I mean, if you think you're acting like a stalker, there's a chance you may well be. and then I think also how you use the data varies depending on what you sell, if you're in the fact of selling, who you're speaking to, and also the permissions that the person's given you to speak to them. I mean, the example that when we spoke before about this, a question I thought about was a while ago, I was trying to organise a birthday party for my 8-year-old daughter, and so I said, I'd get you a bouncy castle. I play the good dad card, I'll get a bouncy castle. It was raining, so on the day I phoned up and said, look, you know, we've got to cancel the bouncy castle. I thought that was the end of it. And then he kept on contacting me on WhatsApp every day for weeks, and that felt like harassment because for me, I thought that was just how we're going to speak about that one little purchase, not a continued thing. So that felt wrong, but it also felt particularly wrong because it was in WhatsApp, which I saw as a personal messaging tool, not a professional business tool. Mm. So for me, that was wrong. But then if you take about why I say it changes the different audiences, we do quite a lot of work with clients in the Middle East, and they want WhatsApp more than they might want email at some time. So I think you've got to sort of listen a little bit and make your own path.
Yeah, I mean, I would totally agree. I mean, I think just because you have data doesn't mean you should use data. And that's, you know, just because you have knowledge doesn't mean you should use it. Like, I think I always kind of try to think back of, like, the real world. If I go in and I buy a suit or a pair of shoes or whatever it might be, and I go into the store the very first time, how do I want to be approached? How do I want that engagement to go? If somebody's like, hey, I see you looking at these particular trousers, can I help you? Or if somebody's like, oh, you look like you've got long legs. Maybe you like these trousers or whatever it might be. I think, you know, for the first experience, you want to try and build trust. And it's very easy to erode trust. I think over time, as you build that understanding of who the person is, you want to use the information that you have to benefit the user so that it's user-centric or, you know, consumer-centric as opposed to marketer-centric. Mm-hmm. Ultimately, at the end of the day, we're all chasing numbers. Marketers are chasing, you know, click-through rates, open rates, impressions, whatever the numbers are. We're all chasing these numbers. And the temptation is, like a sales rep working behind in a store selling suits, the temptation is to go after your goal. But I think if you turn it around and you try and be empathetic and try and be at service to the people that you're dealing with, everything else will look after itself. Yeah. So I think empathy is a big part of it, and just, you know, using good judgment, really.
It's a really good point, actually. Since we're talking about the Middle East as well, you know, there's, I think in 2016, 425 different marketing metrics that we can measure. So that idea of just because we can measure everything doesn't mean that we should. I had the chance to ask the news director of Al Jazeera a while ago exactly that question. Because when they were looking at dark social, and there was another very, very big news network in the US, which we, are we filming?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, so which we can't name. the thing is, you look at some of these sites, you look at BuzzFeed and, you know, kind of Daily Mail and stuff, and it's all about how do you get a story thousandth of a second faster than somebody else before you need to go and pay for it to try and get the eyeballs back up. And the problem is with a lot of those stories that are now being shared on messaging apps, especially in the Far East, it's really, really hard. So there was this phrase that was being bounced around called morally deep and ethically grey, which you can read into that what you will. And it was this idea of at what point can we try and figure out what someone said on a private messaging app in order to figure out, is this likely to be a news story because traffic somewhere else has spiked? So I was saying, how do you balance that? And his response was basically, look, if you're listening to your customers, then you're going to know straight away. And I said, well, what do you measure? And he had this thing called the 5 W's, which I've used 1,000 times since. He said, these are the only things you need to worry about, and you'll always be okay if you just do these. Just measure 5 W's, who, what, why, where, and when. Who are my customers? What are they saying? When did they say those things? Why did those conversations take place and where? And he just has a dashboard set up in real time, and that's all it shows. I love that.
Yeah, that's really interesting. I was at an event earlier in the year, and one of the concepts was to be subtle. And I think that being subtle is also how you use the data to make sure that you're not invading somebody's trust or privacy with you. And I think that, you know, really plays in with all of these stories shared.